Hi, and welcome to the second part of my mini-series on how valve guitar amplifiers work. Today we're going to be looking at power supplies. And in particular, we want to answer the question, what is this great big chunk of iron in your valve amplifier which makes the thing so darn heavy? Well, the answer is that inside the amplifier are various sections which require different voltages. Let me give you a few examples. You need a very, very high voltage, which is called the HT, often 300 or 400 volts. You need a much lower voltage, 6.3 volts, which drives the heating elements of the valves. Sometimes if your amp has a rectifier tube, that requires a completely different voltage, 5 volts, for its heater. And then you also need a negative voltage, which does your negative bias. And of course, in some amplifiers, the more modern ones with transistors and op amps inside, you need things like 5 volts and for the logic, and plus and minus 15 volts for the op amps. But they are the more modern transistor amplifiers. So we're going to be looking now in a little bit of depth, not too much, we'll do a little bit of theory, but hopefully just enough to keep you interested in exactly how we get the 240 volts AC that's coming in from the mains transformed, useful word that, into all of these different voltages which we find within the amplifier. The main piece of circuitry or ironmongery which does it is this, which is the mains transformer for your amplifier. The bigger and heavier the transformer, the more power it's able to supply. And if you have a transistor amplifier with not much power, the power transformer can be quite small. But for big old valve amplifiers, you tend to have quite a bit of ironmongery in the form of the power valve. Of the power transformer, sorry. And of course, all that that does is to take the 240 volts AC input and transform it down to a lower voltage. Well, actually, most of the voltages are a bit lower, but of course, we have one high voltage too. We have the 300, 400, 500 volt HT. So it transforms from the 240 volts AC up to 300 or 400 volts AC and down to 6.3 volts, 5 volts, minus 50 volts for the bias, and whatever other voltages are required. How does it do that? It's very simple. It's a two-part transformer which has a primary winding. So imagine you get yourself a cardboard tube and you wind a coil of wire around it. That's the primary winding, and that goes to the 240 volts AC. And then you put some insulation over that wire and you wind your secondaries on top of that. So if you want to step down the voltage, you would have fewer turns on the secondary than you do on the primary. For example, if you had 1,000 turns on the primary and 100 turns on the secondary, the 240 volts will be transformed to 24 volts. If you put a few more turns on the secondary than the primary, you'd have the opposite effect. So for example, if you wanted 500 volts, you might have 1,000 turns on the primary and 2,000 turns on the secondary, and that would transform up the voltage from 240, 250 volts up to 500 volts or so. So it's just two coils of wire which are separated by some sort of insulation. How does it work? Well, it's magic really, but if you remember your school physics classes, maybe you might remember a coil of wire. If you took a bar magnet and pushed it in and out of the coil of wire, the voltmeter would flicker, and that's because the magnetic field is being induced into the coil. Well, a mains transformer is exactly that. The primary field goes up and down like this as the AC varies, and that cuts the coils of the secondary and induces into it another voltage which follows it exactly in synchronization, but of course with a different voltage depending on the turns ratio. Well, let's have a look at a little bit of theory about how we get that AC transformed into a useful DC voltage to supply, for example, our HT. We'll have a look at that now. Let's just do a quick summary of how a power supply works. It has three stages. The transformation, which is done by the transformer, the rectification, which is done by diodes, and the smoothing, which is done by filter capacitors. Now, the way this works is that your 240 volts AC comes in here. It goes into our transformer, and if you remember, we have a number of windings coming off the secondary which transform this 240 volts into a higher or a lower voltage. Let's just consider one winding for the moment. And so out of our transformer comes, so we have a higher voltage coming out here of say 300 or 400 volts. This now gets rectified by a diode or diodes, and we'll be coming onto this in a moment, to produce a sort of a DC, but it's a kind of a choppy DC with a lot of hum on it. What's actually happened is that these bottom parts of the sine wave have been rectified to fill in here. This bottom part's been rectified to fill in here, so you end up with this kind of choppy signal after rectification. If you were to listen to that, it would be very hummy. You'd hear a very, very loud hum, which, by the way, is what you hear if your filter capacitors have dried out and are no longer working. So then this choppy AC signal here is smoothed out by big fat filter capacitors to produce a nice steady state DC voltage of whatever voltage we want. In this particular case, it would be the HT, which would be 300 to 500 volts DC. So those are the three stages. Let's have a quick look at each of them in turn, starting with transformation. This is the circuit symbol for our transformer. So if you see that on a schematic, you know what it is. Here is our primary winding. Here is just one secondary winding shown. And so our 240 volts AC will be coming in here. And our transformed AC voltage, higher or lower, will be coming out here. How does it work? Well, very briefly, our main signal goes from 240 volts down to zero, 50 times a second. So if you imagine that this terminal is suddenly taken to 240 volts and this terminal to zero, current will flow through the primary here, and the important thing is the magnetic field of the primary will expand out like that, and it will cut the turns of the secondary and induce into the secondary a voltage depending on the turns ratio. So when this goes positive, this goes positive. Now when this goes down, the other part of our AC cycle, this goes down to zero. When this goes down to zero, the magnetic field that was out here collapses back in. So previously the magnetic field cutting this term was going out. Now it collapses back in, which is the opposite sense of field. And so basically this goes positive and this goes negative. So as this goes up and down, this also switches in its polarity to produce an AC signal from the secondary. So that's how that works. Our transformers typically have more than one winding. Hope you can see this, not fantastically clear, I agree, but I just want to show you the circuit symbol for a more typical situation that we have. Here is our primary winding with our 240 volts AC, and here are a number of secondaries. This is much more like a real life scenario. So this might be our HT winding, giving us several hundred volts. This might be our 6.3 volt filament winding for the heaters of the valves. This might be our, let's say it could be our bias winding, giving us minus 60 volts or so. I'll be telling you in a later module why we have a negative voltage here, why we require a negative minus 60. And there might be another winding with 5 volts for the heater of a rectifier tube if your amplifier has a rectifier tube. Just before I go on to the diode, I thought you might like to see an actual schematic for an amplifier. I opened this at random in my book. It's a Yorkville Sound Bassmate. Never heard of it. It doesn't matter because they all have very similar power supplies. And here you can see our symbol for the transformer with its two windings in this particular case. There's the primary, and there's the one secondary, which is doing the HT, and there's another secondary, which is probably doing the heaters. Fuse on the input, and we haven't covered it yet, but just for your interest, here are the diodes that are doing the rectification to produce that choppy DC, and here are the smoothing capacitors that are smoothing it to produce a nice steady DC at the output, but we'll cover that in a moment. I also want to show you an actual amplifier, so I'll go and dig out an amplifier and we'll have a peek inside at the mains transformer. Well, here we are, top side of a typical 60s Fender amplifier, and here is our mains transformer. This one's been replaced with a 240 volt version. It was originally 115. Nothing much to show you there, a big chunk of ironmongery. However, out of interest, behind it is a rectifier valve, so this contains effectively two diodes which are going to rectify the sine wave output of this transformer into that rather choppy, lumpy, semi-DC signal that we saw on the diagram. Let's flip it over and have a look on the underside. Here we are on the underside. Here's the mains transformer. Primary winding, secondary windings. It might look like a fair few. Well, there are 4 or 5 wires going into the primary there, but a primary typically has a number of taps on it so that you can run it on 120 volts or 215 volts or 230 volts or whatever. So these purple wires are actually just cable tied out of the way, they're not even used. Only the white and the grey there are used on the primary side. Now over on the secondary side, you can see we have a number of windings, just like on our diagram. Starting off with these green ones, these are the 6.3 volt windings for the heaters of the valves. The heater is the bit you see on a valve when it glows, and and it tells you nothing whatsoever about the status of the health of the valve, it just tells you that it's glowing, so you can't tell anything just because a valve is on. These two red wires here are the HT. It's typically 300, 0, 300, so there's a centre tap here, and the centre tap comes out on this green wire and goes to chassis. So that's the HT. This blue wire is our bias voltage, our negative bias voltage, and that goes all the way around to a little bias board there where it has a diode of its own and a smoothing capacitor of its own to produce the minus 60 volts. And then finally, because this is a valve rectifier, it requires 5 volts for its heater. No idea why, can't remember. And so this two yellow wires here are the 5 volts for the heater of the rectifier valve. And that's it. That's our transformation for us. We saw it in the Fender. Out of it comes the AC voltage of the level that we want. The next thing we do is to rectify it to produce this choppy signal, which is kind of semi-DC and semi-AC. So let's have a quick look here. That's done by a thing called a diode, and that is the symbol, the circuit symbol for a diode. It's actually quite a handy symbol because it shows you that this device here passes current just in one direction. So when you make this positive and this negative, current will flow through this diode. If you make this positive and this negative, no current can flow back through that way. So let's now have a look at how that works in an actual circuit. We usually have at least two diodes to produce our rectification. Now remember, when this goes positive and this is negative, the field expands and this goes positive and this goes negative. On our typical power supply, we normally take this center to ground. So let's see what happens when this does go positive. Well, current can flow through the diode. Remember, it's happy to go through that way, through the load, which is our amplifier, and back down to ground. So we have current flowing through our load. That's nice. But what happens now when this goes positive and this goes negative on the other cycle? Well, now the current can now flow through this diode, because this is positive, through the load and down to ground. Nothing goes through that diode. And then a 50th of a second later, it reverses. That goes positive again. That goes negative. Current flows this way. Then it switches again. Current flows this way. So current is always flowing, you will notice, through the load that way. But it's a bit kind of choppy. You know, it looks a bit like this. In fact, it looks exactly like that. That's how a rectifier works. You have two choices of what device you use for your rectifier. I'm going to give you a couple of options. You can use this, which costs 5p, or you can use this, which costs about £14 or £15. This is a much superior rectifier to this, and costs a fraction of the money, takes up a fraction of the real estate, and is altogether a better deal. So it won't surprise you to know that the diode rectifier, semiconductor diode rectifier, completely took over from tube rectifiers, and tube rectifiers are almost never used these days apart from in guitar amplifiers. Valve guitar amplifiers, I should say. Why is that? Well, apart from the fact that a lot of them are antiques and they take these rectifiers, the rectifier, because it's not a very good rectifier, has a certain amount of sag on it. So when you play a chord, the voltage tends to dip down because the poor old rectifier can't handle it. And guitarists have come to like that sound and enjoy the rectifier sag, as it's called. So anyway, that's what your choice is. Let's now turn to the final part of the power supply, which is the smoothing. We have this very choppy DC here, AC-DC, and we want to smooth out those lumps and produce a nice solid DC line of whatever voltage it is we are looking for. That's accompanied by something called a smoothing capacitor, and that's what we're going to be looking at next. Let's have a quick look at the circuit symbols for a capacitor. There are two sorts of capacitor: polarized, they have a positive and negative, and non-polarized. The polarized ones tend to be the larger value capacitors, and they need to be put in the circuit a particular way around, whereas the smaller capacitors usually just pass signals and they do not need to be put a certain way around in the amplifier. The symbols keep changing. This is a symbol I grew up with, where this was the positive side of the capacitor and this was a negative, but this is the more modern symbol, where that's the positive and the curved line is the more negative. This is the non-polarized capacitor. We measure capacitance value in things called farads, after Michael Faraday. However, a farad is an unreasonably large capacitor, approximately equal in size to the average two-story house. So it's not a usable amount. And so typically we measure in fractions of a farad, and in the case of our smoothing capacitors, the bigger capacitors, we tend to measure in what are called microfarads. A micro, as you know, being a millionth of a farad. So a typical smoothing capacitor might be 22 microfarads, so 22 millionths of a farad. Some of them are a bit larger, 47 microfarads, even 100 microfarads, but you won't see anything over 100 microfarads in the smoothing circuit. When we get down to signal capacitors, they're way smaller in value, and they are typically measured in nanofarads. A nanofarad being 10 to the minus 9 of a farad. And even smaller, some of the small signal capacitors are measured in picofarads, which is a 10 to the minus 12, a million millionths of a farad. Well, what do they actually look like? Well, let me show you something interesting. This is a 100 microfarad capacitor. And that is a 100 microfarad capacitor. Maybe a little bit surprising. Why the difference in size? This is what you will find in your valve amplifier. You won't find this. The difference is what's called the working voltage. So when I look on the side of this, you probably won't be able to see, but it says 100 microfarads at 25 volts. So you can't put more than 25 volts across this capacitor. This one is 100 microfarads at 450 volts. So you can put 450 volts across this capacitor. And of course, those are typically the voltages that we see in a valve amplifier. Here's another example. You'll see these quite often in valve amplifiers. They are split capacitors. So this is 50 and 50, 50 plus 50 at 500 volts. So there are two capacitors in one can here. Here are the connections here. There's the ground, or negative if you like. That's one 50 microfarad capacitor across those two terminals, and another 50 microfarad capacitor across those two terminals. Quite common to see these, usually big silver things, in valve amplifiers. Let's now just have a quick peek inside our amplifier, and I'll point out the smoothing capacitors to you. On this Fender amplifier, the smoothing capacitors are stored underneath this hood here. So let's whip the cover off there and see what's lurking underneath. Here we are underneath the hood, and you can see that this amplifier has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 smoothing capacitors, several stages of filtration to make sure we get nice hum-free DC. And you can see I actually recapped this amp myself, and I'd like to put in 600 volt capacitors at 30 microfarads. That gives plenty of margin for the voltage. The smoothing capacitor works by storing charge, and by storing and releasing charge it can smooth out those lumps in the AC waveform that we saw. The more you have and the bigger the number of microfarads, the more smoothing you get, but of course the larger and more expensive the capacitors. I thought you might like to see another real life schematic. Let me show you what's going on here. Mains inlet, on-off switch, fuse, don't worry about that capacitor. Primary winding of the transformer. Three secondary windings here. This one you can clearly see is marked to the heaters and the on-off light, so that's our 6.3 volts AC. We don't need to rectify the filament voltage. I thought this might interest you because instead of a semiconductor diode, this has a rectifier tube in, and all there is a diode between here and here, and a diode between here and here. So just like on our previous diagram which showed the diodes. If you remember, we also took our center tap to ground. That little arrow there means ground, and so the current can go through one diode off to the smoothing capacitors, or through the other diode off to the smoothing capacitors. And we have two smoothing capacitors here, a 10 microfarad at 450 volts that goes off to feed the output transformer, and then we have a little bit of a drop down resistor to produce a lower voltage, 250 volts, which goes off to do the preamp tubes. And again, 10 microfarads at 450 volts. So a very typical tube amp power supply. Well, I hope you enjoyed that and found it educational and interesting. The sharp-eyed amongst you will notice it took me so long to film. I've had a change of clothes. But I hope you've learned that you can take one of these great big chunks of ironmongery and combine it with either this or a five-penny diode or two. Smooth it with a couple of hefty capacitors to produce all the lovely stable DC voltages that you need inside your valve amplifier. Well, that's a wrap from me. I hope you'll enjoy the following video I'm about to do, which is how a valve works. I'll be going into that in some detail with you, and so you'll know how rectifier valves work, preamp valves work, and power valves work. I'll see you then.